Good afternoon. Open my life, Lord. Moses presents us with a choice, death and adversity, or a life cracked open to the love of God. Writing to the Galatians, Paul tells us that we have died to the law so that we might live again to God. It is no longer we who live, but Christ who lives in us. Amen. Please stand as you are able. When our lives are joyous and laughter abounds,
Christ is dwelling there.
When the news is grim and we have nowhere to turn,
Christ is dwelling there.
In the water and the word, the bread and the wine,
Christ is dwelling there.
In our life and our death, in the new life to come,
Christ is dwelling there.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Open our lives, Lord, to reflect your glory. Lead us to the cross, to the grave, to the empty tomb, and into the world as imitators of Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy, the 30th chapter. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away, you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them. I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him. For that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Our psalm today is Psalm 16, and we will read it responsively by whole verse. Protect me, O God, for in you I take refuge.
I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you.
As for the holy ones in the land, they are the noble, in whom is all my delight.
Those who choose another God multiply their sorrows. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names upon my lips.
The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot.
The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage.
I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me.
I keep the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand. I shall not be moved.
Therefore my heart is glad, and my soul rejoices. My body also rests secure.
For you do not give me an eye to show, or let your faithful ones see the pit.
You show me the path of life. A reading from the book of Galatians, the second chapter. We ourselves are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners. Yet we know that a person is justified not by the works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. And we have come to believe in Christ Jesus so that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by doing the works of the law. Because no one will be justified by the works of the law. But if, in our effort to be justified in Christ, we ourselves have been found to be sinners, is Christ then a servant of sin? Certainly not. But if I build up again the very things that I once tore down, then I demonstrate that I am a transgressor. For through the law I died to the law, so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if justification comes through the law, then Christ died for nothing.
Wow, how is it week 5 in Lent already? I suppose those individuals that have chosen to give up something significant in their lives during this 40 days probably think it's gone really slow. I personally can't believe it will be Holy Week next week. This has been a great journey, and now here we are. Open our lives, Lord. What does this mean? We have spent the last 4 weeks opening parts of ourselves, our eyes, hands, ears, and hearts, and now our lives. Open our lives in a dominantly white ELCA church or community? How do we assist this world we live in with inclusivity? This white privileged world that needs to change. The God that I know and worship embraces all of his children, and we are all beloved in God's eyes. What have we done to change our church? In reading Dear Church by Lenny Duncan, an ordained, queer, African-American, ELCA pastor in the United States, I found it hard to hear what a queer person of color thinks about the ELCA. The fact that we need to work on our church full of racism and one that demonstrates a lack of acceptance for the LGBTQIA+ communities. That this pastor went completely through seminary with instructors and pastors that were all a part of the LGBTQIA+ in one way or another, but have never felt that they could be authentic with the church or their workplace because they all knew the responses they would receive. The response would not be inclusivity. It would not be thank you for being vulnerable enough to be authentic. And it would not include a hug or a smile. Lenny stated that he has not been honest about this, about being queer, until writing this book, Dear Church. He is very aware that there are very few bishops and candidacy committees that would have been accepting of his honesty during seminary. Since I serve on the candidacy committee in the Northeastern Iowa Synod, I would love to tell you that my eyes, hands, ears, heart, and life would have been open to hearing who Lenny truly is inside and out. Have I followed all of the commandments and decrees that the Lord has given us? Is my life open to others that are near and far from me? And have I allowed the Lord to enter my life and be the center of everything that I do? How about you? How are you living your life? Is it open? Have you let the Lord in to do his work through you? Have we all died so that Christ might live through us? In the fall of 2011, I embarked on a new adventure to obtain my doctoral degree in nursing. I spent the next 3 years studying self-care in the nursing profession. My research demonstrated that self-care is not selfish. It is a necessity. If we don't take care of ourselves first, we have nothing to give to others. As many of you know, in the 7 years since I completed this program, self-care has become a real buzzword in many helping professions, for school teachers, pastors, and everyone that works in healthcare. This week, I read an article in the Journal of Christian Nursing written by Rachel Spurlock, an RN, and she introduced me to the concept that self-care is stewardship. What? Yeah, that's what I said, stewardship. Now, I was a complete skeptic about this, and maybe you are too. Stewardship, to me, has always meant the most difficult committee in the church to serve on, right? And I served on it here at Zion, so I know what I'm talking about. And serving confirmed absolutely everything I already thought. So how is my passion for self-care converted to stewardship? If I have truly opened my life to Christ and let him into my eyes, hands, ears, and heart as well, can you think of a better way to take care of myself? Wouldn't this be the ultimate self-care plan? Rachel Spurlock could not get past the fact that self-care was selfish. So now she knows that it is not selfish, and she gives others the best version of herself. But she also does this with stewardship and gratitude. Gratitude to God for making her a beloved child and giving her that love in her heart and life to share with others through stewardship. The stewardship of love and care to her family, her patients, her church members, and all of God's children, and the love to operate from a space of inclusion and acceptance of all. So let us end this Lenten season by opening our lives to God as a part of our own self-care. Or if self-care is selfish to you, as part of your own stewardship. Stewardship that is no longer difficult, and full of dread, but instead allows us to use our opened life towards all of God's children. Stewardship that involves inclusivity, cultural awareness, social justice, no more racism, and openness to authenticity and vulnerability. Open our lives, Lord, to stewardship. Amen. Please stand as you are able. Let us pray. Lord of all life, when we cannot see the beauty of your creation,
open our eyes that all living things thrive and grow.
When we neglect the poor, the sick, and the grieving,
open our hands to do your work in the world.
When we ignore the cries of injustice in our midst, when we are hardened against our neighbor,
open our hearts and heal our resentment.
When we are closed to the grace you long to give us,
open our lives and turn us to follow the way of the cross.
Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Let us pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Go into the world with eyes open to the transforming light of Christ, hands open to serve those you meet, ears open to the call of the Spirit, hearts open to the bountiful love of God, and lives open to follow Christ to the cross. The God who opened for us the way of everlasting life, bless you now and forever. Amen. Go in peace. Christ is with you.
Thanks be to God.